Can you talk a little bit about how this technology is also being used in museums? You already mentioned the Boston Museum that this was an exhibit for, but I understand that's traveling now as well.
Well, we've been able to display these models in several places so far, and we have more coming up. For example, there was a show at the Oriental Institute Museum in Chicago about imaging and imagining the past, and so this model was on a display screen in that exhibit. And then in Hildesheim, Germany, last year there was a special exhibition on Giza, and they also borrowed the models and had it on display there. And then next year, I believe opening in January 2013, there is a special Giza exhibition opening in Vienna at the Art Museum, or the Kunsthistorisches Museum there. And we hope to have a big display and maybe go over for a presentation in May of that year and show these models. They also have one particular tomb chapel excavated by the German-Austrian expedition in 1912, and that whole tomb chapel is reconstructed in Vienna in the museum. And we have it here in our model too, so we can see it in 3D, and we hope to bring that over and help the Austrians enjoy that particular tomb chapel in the flesh, in the limestone, and also as a 3D model.
Can you talk about how this is something that's ongoing or continue to expand based on what's going on over there and current excavations?
Well, our goal is nothing short of Giza past, Giza present, and Giza future. So we're still chasing all the old documentation, the photographs, the notes, the diaries, not just from the Harvard MFA expedition, but from all the other players who are working at the site. So that's Turin, it's Vienna, it's Berlin, it's Leipzig, it's Hildesheim, Philadelphia, Berkeley, and of course Cairo. So we're constantly assembling all this material, and we've just scratched the surface, so to speak. We have many, many more tombs to build. And then there's work going on now at Giza. Their excavation's continuing, and so new data's coming in, and that forces us to reevaluate and reconfigure our models. But in the 3D space, it's a wonderful opportunity because we can show then, we can show now, we can try to restore and reconstruct things, we can alter the data as new information comes in. So it's a pretty versatile environment.
How do you see this technology impacting the way students will learn moving forward, even beyond Harvard, but in universities around the world?
Well, visualization is a pretty hot topic in education now, and there are all sorts of online initiatives. We're moving in some ways even beyond the classroom. So this is an exciting experiment in that direction. It doesn't completely replace the traditional lecture format or section meetings and interactions with students, but in addition, we bring them into this room and they can experience Giza in a whole new way. When I teach archaeological survey courses or history courses of ancient Egypt, I would love to have this kind of opportunity all up and down the Nile to bring them into other sites as well. But our focus up to this point is Giza, so this is a highlight of some of my courses. Someday there will be similar models of Karnak Temple and Abu Simbel and Deir el-Bersha and many other famous sites up and down the Nile, sites in ancient Nubia, which is modern Sudan. And bit by bit we're getting there, but we think we've got a jump on the Giza necropolis so far.
Just from the simulation standpoint, how long of a process is it to get what we're seeing behind you built?
Well, at Giza there are all sorts of monuments, from barely begun to semi-finished to beautifully decorated, carved, and painted. And there are large monuments and small monuments. And then, of course, the objects that come out of the tombs as well. So there are statues, there are false doors with inscribed niches and hieroglyphic inscriptions. There are stone vessels and ceramic vessels and other types of implements of daily life. So each one presents a different kind of challenge. An unfinished tomb with no decoration can be built fairly easily. One that has multiple chambers and lots of carved and painted walls and inscriptions, that's more of a challenge. And the issue comes up, what do we want to show? Do we want to show this tomb as it looks in 2012? Do we want to show it in 1910 when the expedition first found it? Or do we want to go all the way back to 2500, 2600 BC when these tombs were first created and try to reconstruct and restore, complete the colors and finish off inscriptions when we know how they should be reconstructed and try to give a sense of 4th dynasty or 5th dynasty Giza architecture? All of those are possibilities, all of them have a value, and hopefully we'll get to the point where we can toggle back and forth and the students will be able to travel in time from the present day to the excavator's day all the way back to the Old Kingdom.